And as you can hear now, it is actually, I've started the recording function so that I know that it is recording. And we'll make that link available to our YouTube channel so that you can share it with those who are not able to participate this evening, as well as some resources that the Hemlock Restoration Initiative will be sharing with us this evening, and information about next month's program, which I'll share at the conclusion of this program. We are also on Facebook Live. So if you follow the Village Green on our friends with the Village Green on our Facebook page, you will be able to view to that link there, and also share it that way. And if you did not register in advance to participate in the program, I encourage you to email me. I am director@cashersgreen.com. And when you email me, if you were not pre-registered, I will make sure that you're included in that follow-up emailing with all the good information that I just shared previously. So there are a few more people entering the waiting room. I'll repeat some of this information again. I'm going to let them in, and I'm going to actually share my screen because I'm going to share a promotional video that explains a little bit about the Village Green and the Highlands Cashers Land Trust and our mutual mission and endeavors towards conservation on the plateau. Thank you. And so I hope you have enjoyed this presentation, which I am now stopping. And I will just repeat some of the comments that I made to begin with. I'm Ann Self. I'm the village, the director, executive director of the Village Green and Cashers. You saw a little bit about us in that promotional video. We are 13 acres of privately concerned public parkland for community enjoyment. And it is my pleasure to welcome you to this month's Village Nature Series program. If you are just joining us, reminders that as you come in, to make sure you mute yourself and stay muted through the program. We are being recorded, so I will make a link to the recording available to you. We're also live on our Village Green Facebook page, so there'll be different ways that you can access this information and return to it again. In addition to that link that I will be sending in a follow-up email, I will actually also send any resources that Logan and Tom share with us this evening, as well as how to be in touch directly with them. I will also encourage you to go ahead and put your view on the speaker view now, so that the you don't have to hunt through the matrix, the Brady Bunch matrix of the Zoom, to discern who's speaking, and you'll be able to see Tom and Logan's screens clearly as part of their presentation. And also just a reminder that that both the Land Trust and the Village Green are 501c3 nonprofit organizations, and we depend on donations from participants like you to support programming such as the Village Nature Series. If you're interested in knowing about that, you can visit the Village Green website, our events calendar, and you can learn about all the dates for the upcoming programs this summer, as well as a link to how to donate and contribute to Village Nature Series. And then also you'll be able to learn about all of the community events that the Village Green will be hosting in 2021. We're excited that with the easing of restrictions, that we are able to offer events, concerts, community programs, and so you'll find those listed on the calendar as well. So thank you again for joining us, and I'm going to now introduce Gary Wine, who is my colleague and the executive director of the Highlands Cashers Land Trust. He'll say a brief word to you about their mission and work, and then he'll introduce this evening's program.
Hi, everybody. I want to welcome you to the second presentation in the 2021 Village Nature Series. The particular talk is absolutely wonderful, and I'm really excited about it. The Land Trust has been around since 1883. We currently conserve over 3,700 acres in 111 places, and these are places that you all know, places like the Bear Shadow, places like Ravenel Park, Satula, McKinney Meadow, and we're excited to do it. Before I forget, because I will if I don't say this now, next presentation in the Village Nature Series is on June 29th, and it is Take Nothing But Pictures, Leave Nothing But Footprints, and that's with the Friends of Panther Town. So, I first met Tom, I have to, back in 2015, and he is a graduate student just starting at Western Carolina, and he had just shown up from Oregon. And I think he was scared to death that the flora in Western North Carolina was going to be so different. And so I can actually recall spending an afternoon out near Lake Fontana with Tom, identifying what few plants I knew, and he was surprisingly good at picking things up. There are a lot of things that they're not too different between Oregon. And then I watched Tom go on and get a master's degree at Western. And he's currently a outreach associate for the Hemlock Restoration Initiative. And he has with him a cohort in crime. It's Logan Dye, who's an AmeriCorps member. And I don't know if this is a weird incidence or not, but my land, our land trust also has an AmeriCorps, and his first name is Logan, and he's actually on the views, Logan Callum. He's another AmeriCorps. You're everywhere. Logan is in his first year. He's a stewardship and conservation education associate, but he's a local. He's from Brevard. He's not too far from home. So the two of them, and I don't know how they're going to do it, they're going to do a tag team, but they're going to talk about hope for the hemlocks. And I'm kind of proud. Tom informed me he's going to show a picture of one of my favorite trees. Tom, Logan, go for it. It's all yours.
And I'm going to make it available for them to share their screen. And as they are preparing to share their screen with you for the presentation, I did put a comment in the chat to encourage you, if you have questions during this presentation that you'd like to ask, to please type them. Just use that at the bottom of your Zoom screen, the chat bubble. Click on that and then type your question. I'll curate those questions and ask those of Tom and Logan at the conclusion of their presentation. So they should have the ability to share their screen now. Yes. Yep, there we go.
Sweet. All right, well, I'm going to take the first portion of our presentation. And thanks for that introduction. If it's loading for everyone. So again, I'm Logan Dye. I'm the AmeriCorps Stewardship and Conservation Education Associate with the Hemlock Restoration Initiative. And I'm excited to talk to all of y'all about hemlocks today. So just a brief presentation overview. So I'm going to talk about what the Hemlock Restoration Initiative is, the importance of hemlocks, and the threat to hemlocks with the Hemlock Wooly Adelgid. And then I'm going to hand it over to Tom, who's going to discuss some of our management approaches, what private landowners can do, and then hopefully we'll have some time for questions at the end of our presentation. So the Hemlock Restoration Initiative is a program of WNC Communities. WNC Communities is a nonprofit organization in North Carolina that's focused around agriculture and community development. You may not have heard of them, but you may have heard of some of their projects. So they're part of the WNC Ag Center, the Livestock Center, the Arboretum, and various programs such as WNC Ag Options, very active in Western North Carolina. And the Hemlock Restoration Initiative is the newest program of WNC Communities. It was established in 2014 by NC Commissioner of Agriculture Steve Troxler when he learned about the plight of the hemlock and wanted to set aside some money, some funding to help combat that issue. And so we're funded by the Forest Service, by the NC Department of Agriculture, NC Policy Collaboratory, and county governments and private donations. Oops. And so we're a collective partnership with a mission of ensuring that Eastern and Carolina hemlocks can withstand the Hemlock Wooly Adelgid, survive to maturity in North Carolina's public and private lands. And so we have, we have dual roles. So we do management. So we're on the ground doing chemical treatment, biocontrol, but we also do education. So we do events like this. We do entire workshops for landowners and try to educate people on this issue. And so here's just sort of a broad overview of what that issue is before we get into some of the nitty details. So hemlocks are a foundation species. Essentially what that means is that they are an incredibly important species to our ecosystems. This is the Hemlock Wooly Adelgid. They are a non-native invasive insect, and they are causing massive die-off, massive mortality of hemlocks. So all of those dead trees that you guys see in this image are hemlocks that have been killed by the Hemlock Wooly Adelgid. And so what do we do? What are we doing to combat this issue? So briefly, first thing we do is we identify and establish hemlock conservation areas here in Western North Carolina, areas that we have deemed to be high priority areas to help boost those hemlock populations. And once we've established these areas, we go in and we increase the number of trees being treated on public lands through primarily chemical treatment. Then we are also implementing integrated pest management and long-term biological control of Hemlock Wooly Adelgid. And we partner with other organizations to help advance the development of other control strategies and restoration techniques. This is includes like silvicultural practices and actually looking to breed and reproduce a genetically resistant hemlock strain. And then we, as mentioned before, educate landowners on how they can economically treat and manage the hemlocks on their own property. And so what we practice is called in situ conservation. This is maintenance and recovery in the original and natural surroundings. So we're gonna go out to hemlocks natural range where they naturally grow, and we're gonna establish those hemlock conservation areas. We're gonna do this primarily on pretty much all public land. So state parks, state forests, Wildlife Resource Commission game lands, but then some privately conserved lands as well. We develop an adaptive long-term management plan and for that hemlock conservation area. And we're not just doing this targeting mature and old growth forests. We're also doing young forests, young areas that are experiencing hemlock regeneration to hopefully then one day become those mature old growth forests. And so here's some images of some hemlock conservation areas. So here's some hemlocks growing along a river. Hemlocks, as we'll get into, are very important in riparian habitats, particularly eastern hemlocks. But they also grow up on bluffs and outcroppings. So this is up in the Asheville watershed. This is along the sandy mush game lands, some more riparian trees. And this is called pirate bush. This is a rare plant species that grows in close junction with hemlocks. So it's important not just to protect hemlocks. They also have some pretty important underbrush that relies on hemlocks. Some more rocky outcrops, very beautiful. And then this is a really cool bonsai Carolina hemlock. This is located in Hanging Rock State Park, which is the easternmost population of Carolina hemlocks. And then this is that really special tree. This is the Choa tree. This is the champion eastern hemlock. It is over 160 feet tall, over 5 feet diameter, and is growing in land conserved by the Highlands Cachers Land Trust. So local, close to y'all. And a really awesome, awesome tree. And so since Hemlock Restoration Initiative has been established, we have established over 100 different hemlock conservation areas in North Carolina. And we've done this with the teamwork and collaboration of a lot of really awesome, really tremendous partners, as well as a great host of dedicated volunteers. So we're appreciative for all of these organizations and people that help make our work possible. And so now let's sort of get into some specifics on hemlocks. Hemlocks are in the genus Suga, which includes 10 different species all across the world. There are 6 species in Asia and 4 here in North America. They all grow at relatively the same latitude with similar climates, but it's sort of important to have this geographical distribution, because the hemlock woolly adelgid, which we are combating, is actually native to some of these species. So there's an adelgid up in the western portion of hemlocks, the western species of hemlocks in North America, as well as where our hemlock woolly adelgid comes from, which is southern Japan. But here is the ranges of the 2 species of hemlocks that we have here in western North Carolina. So there's 2 species. There's eastern hemlock and Carolina hemlock. Eastern hemlock is the light green portion of this map, Suga canadensis. And as you guys can see, has a extremely large and vast range. So it's all the way down in Alabama, Georgia, goes all the way as far north as Nova Scotia, and then travels west into Michigan with some small populations in Minnesota. And then Carolina hemlock, as you can see, Suga carolinia, is that really dark green color. And it is endemic to the Southern Appalachians, so it does not grow anywhere else. And as you guys can see in that map on the right, primarily exists solely in Western North Carolina with just a few populations in neighboring states. So a really cool species to keep your eyes out for. And here's how to sort of identify between those 2 species. So one way is you can think about where you are in the forest. So eastern hemlocks primarily grow along riparian corridors, shady coves, north-facing slopes. They're gonna be in the cooler, damper habitats, whereas Carolina hemlocks grow up high on bluffs and dry ridgetops, much sunnier, much drier, much higher elevation. So that's one distinguishing factor between those two. Another is the foliage. So eastern hemlocks which is this on the right, you can see have needles growing out in flat planes. So if you laid that down on the table, it would lay flat. Whereas Carolina hemlocks, their needles grow in whorls. So if you're able to get a hand on a twig of the hemlock that you're looking to identify, you can see the orientation of those needles. But then if you're maybe the tree's too high or too tall, you can look in the ground and see if you can find some cones. So Eastern hemlocks have a pretty small cone compared to the Carolina hemlock. You can see this image on the right. This is an Eastern hemlock cone, and this is a Carolina hemlock cone. So that Carolina hemlock cone is about twice as large as the Eastern hemlock. And Eastern hemlocks are a lot taller. So Eastern hemlocks can grow up to heights of 175 feet, whereas Carolina hemlocks are a little bit smaller. They may grow up to about 60 feet tall. And so why are we gonna fight to save this species? Why are they so important? Well, as we mentioned, they're a foundation species. So they're literally the foundation of that forest habitat that you're finding them in. They drive entire ecosystems. So they drive food webs by creating shelter for various animal and plant life to form, insects, all sorts of stuff like that lives in hemlocks. They're incredibly important to the hydrology of the area. So Eastern hemlocks in particularly, they grow along those riparian habitats. And one, their dense evergreen foliage shades the streams. And so this shading creates more regulated temperatures and increases the dissolved oxygen content of the streams, which in turn increases the biodiversity of that stream, helps macroinvertebrates live, which then helps trout populations, hellbender populations and the likes. They're also important to stream water quality. So they grow along the banks, they stabilize, they prevent erosion, they prevent nutrient runoff. So very important to hydrology. And because they're photosynthesizing year round, they help with flood mitigation. So when there's a high flood coming through, they'll help pump that water out into the atmosphere, reduce flooding, and then also help keep water in the soil during dry seasons. They're also critical to the structure of the forest. So oftentimes they're gonna be the tallest, largest tree growing in the forest in that area. And so when you're the largest and tallest tree, you're gonna influence sort of what grows around you, what grows under you, and the whole structure of that forest. They're very important to nutrient cycling. So they're a year-round photosynthesizer. They're evergreens. And so they're gonna help with the nitrogen and carbon cycle year-round. And they create their own sort of microclimate. So hemlocks have that dense evergreen foliage that's all the way from the peak of the tree all the way to the base of the tree. As you can see in this image, there's foliage all the way. And so in the summer months, that's gonna be great for shading. It's gonna keep the area cooler. It's going to be sort of a refuge out of that hot sun. And then in the winter time, they're going to maintain their needles, and they're actually going to create warmer habitats. So they're going to act as wind breaks, rain breaks, snow breaks. So if an animal is looking to bed down in a storm or something, they're going to be looking for hemlocks for that. And all of this combined increases the biodiversity of the area, increases the biodiversity. And so when we talk about saving hemlocks and protecting hemlocks, we're not talking about just saving hemlocks. We're not doing it just for that one individual species. It's about maintaining entire ecosystems that rely on those hemlocks, those healthy hemlock stands. And no other tree can fill this niche. There's no one tree that's gonna provide all those ecosystem services that the hemlock is going to. And this is not just, they don't just benefit, you know, forest habitat. They also do really great in communities and urban forests. So they're irreplaceable components of an urban forest. As mentioned, they influence that hydrology. They're gonna provide year-round stormwater mitigation. They're gonna reduce flooding. They have the dense foliage that's gonna be a great shade and privacy tree. So if you're looking for a tree that's gonna keep you cool, but then also keep the neighbors from looking in, you're gonna wanna plant a nice hemlock hedge. And they're gonna do that same windbreak and shelter in winter that they do for animals for your house. So they can help your house stay warmer in the winter by preventing winter winds. And they photosynthesize. They're gonna be pumping carbon out of the air, producing oxygen and helping make that air quality even better than it already is up in the Highlands Caches area. And so now we're gonna transition. I'm gonna talk to you guys about the threat to these trees. What's impacting such an important tree. And that's the hemlock woolly adelgid. You may be familiar with this image on the right. You may have seen this when you're out hiking It's the woolly coating, but this is what the Adelgid really looks like when that woolly coating is scraped away. And then this is an electron microscope image of an Adelgid with that long proboscis. This is what it uses to feed on that tree and then eventually kill it. Here are some other life cycles. So when they're first out of the egg and then start to put on that woolly coat. And they are the single greatest threat to hemlock health and sustainability that we have here in Eastern North America. And so here's a map detailing the spread of hemlock woolly adelgid. So it was first identified in Richmond in 1951, and then in the subsequent decades began to spread a little bit slower than when it really started to ramp up. So from 1968 to 1984, it spread into sort of the Shenandoah Valley area and then up into New Jersey, New York. Through the 90s, it continued its spread. And then by 2000, it was in North Carolina. It was impacting our North Carolina trees. And by 2010, was in pretty much every single North Carolina county that had hemlock population. And now it is as far north all the way up into Nova Scotia. It's moving west into Michigan and is pretty much established throughout the entire southern range of hemlocks. And so what this causes is widespread destruction and high rates of mortality. So when you all are driving around or have been out hiking, you may notice these gray ghosts where all of that foliage has fallen off the tree. These will eventually turn into these sort of gnarly toothpick looking trees. And so if you're seeing that, that's most likely a hemlock that succumbed to hemlock woolly adelgid. And so when you have this high spread destruction, this is gonna cause inbreeding and genetic drift, which is gonna reduce the genetic diversity. When you do reduce the genetic diversity of a species, the adaptability of that species is gonna drastically decrease. So that's gonna make them unsusceptible to any sorts of changes in the environment. So if a drought comes through, it could have some pretty serious implications on the mortality of the hemlocks or with climate change as well. You're gonna reduce that population's fitness to adapt and survive. Eventually, you're gonna lose so many trees that they're gonna be no longer able to sustain themselves and you're gonna have an extinct species. And so how does such a tiny little insect that you need a microscope to really view destroy such large, massive trees? So one, they're fast breeders. So all the individuals that we have here in Eastern North America are female and are capable of reproducing asexually, and they do so twice a year. So you have two generations where every individual is able to produce eggs. Doing so twice a year, they spread very rapidly. They don't have any significant natural predators, no competition, and they have multiple modes of dispersal. So they can disperse via wind, birds, other animals, you know, getting on that tree, and then also people, primarily through the movement of nursery stock. And hemlocks are an incredibly abundant host. So when they are dispersing, when they do get in the wind or on a bird's feet or something like that, odds are they're going to pretty easily be able to find another hemlock, another host, and are going to establish on that tree. Through the 50s and into the subsequent decades, as it first began its spread, there wasn't really any federal regulatory restrictions or aggressive early actions, such as quarantining an area. And so this allowed hemlock woolly adelgid to sort of quietly spread and establish a large population. And then when they get into an area, as you just saw, they destroy hemlocks by their feeding habits. So they deplete the plant's nutrients with that long proboscis that you saw. They suck out the carbohydrates and sugars. And when a tree starts experiencing this, it causes a drought-like reaction. And so when a hemlock experiences a drought, they start to shed their needles. And so they'll begin to shed needles from the bottom up. So if you're out and you see a tree that might not be looking so healthy, you'll probably notice that those needles are starting to shed from the bottom up. And eventually they're going to shed so many needles that the tree is no longer going to be able to photosynthesize enough to survive, and they're going to die. And so have you ever seen one of these adelgids really up close? Well, they look like that. A little bit spooky, huh? No, but seriously, they do share some characteristics with these gremlins. And so one is that hemlocks have been known to do a little bit better in the sunlight. So when a hemlock is receiving full sun. The adelgid don't seem to impact the tree quite as much, similar to gremlins. And so, as I mentioned, there's two life cycles of that of the hemlock wooly adelgid every year. So there's a long life cycle, and then there's a short life cycle. The long life cycle starts in June, and those crawlers hatch out of the eggs, and then they enter a dormancy or an estivation period from about July into November, December area, where they begin to break that dormancy and start putting on their white woolly coat that's characteristic of them. And then in March, April, they're gonna have those eggs. Those eggs are gonna hatch, and there's gonna be a rapid spring generation. So this generation doesn't enter dormancy. It hatches and immediately starts putting out white fluff, has eggs, and those eggs hatch and start that long generation over again. So you can see how a large population would spring out very quickly, even from just a few adelgid. And so adelgid aren't the only pests that are affecting hemlock, so it's important to take note of this. So if you are a landowner and you have some hemlocks on your property and you're noticing a decline in health, it may not be hemlock wooly adelgid. And so you want to make sure you know what is causing that decline before you spend the money and time on treating a hemlock. And so here's just some other common examples. So here on the left is hemlock borer. Hemlock borer is a beetle whose larva lives in the inner bark of the tree. And what you'll see here is a reddening of the bark. So if you look out and your hemlock bark looks red, this is caused by woodpeckers pecking away the bark to get to that larva. And so you'll also may notice some bark chips along the base of your tree. So if you notice that, you may have a hemlock borer infestation. And I will note that hemlock borers are rarely a large enough issue to be at infestation levels. When this happens, it normally is because there's another stressor on your tree, such as hemlock wooly adelgid, but it could also be drought or wind blow or something like that. So just be on a lookout for maybe a second health issue. Up here is damage caused by spider mites. Here is a hemlock tip blight. So if the tip of y'all's hemlocks are starting to die back, you could have a hemlock tip blight. And then there's a few different root rots. But what you're most likely going to come across is this elongate hemlock scale. So here's a closer look. And so elongate hemlock scale is really common. And as you guys can see in this photograph, also puts out a white woolly sort of substance. But how you guys are going to be able to distinguish whether you have a hemlock scale or hemlock adelgid on your trees is that hemlock scale is always going to be on the needle. So when you're looking at this image, you can see that the white fluff, the little scales, these are on the needle of the hemlock branch. If you have a hemlock adelgid problem, this is gonna be along the twig. They're always gonna be on the twig. They're never gonna be on the needle. And so that's how you can distinguish between hemlock elongate hemlock scale and hemlock wooly adelgid is where it is on the branch. And elongate hemlock scale can have negative impacts on your tree, but you're not gonna experience the mortality or destruction that you will from hemlock wooly adelgid. And so that was sort of a brief intro into sort of the importance of hemlocks and what is happening to them. And now I'm gonna turn it over to Tom, who is going to talk to you all about what we are doing to combat this issue and what you all are as landowners or concerned citizens will be able to do as well. So I'm gonna turn it over to Tom.
Awesome, thanks Logan. So now that Logan's given some great background on the importance of hemlocks, what an important tree they are, and then the threat they're facing from hemlock wooly adelgid, I'm gonna cover kind of an overview of some of these different strategies that are being used, that we're using to control hemlock wooly adelgid, and then touch on some things that you can do as a landowner. So for hemlock wooly adelgid, we are pursuing an integrated pest management approach. And basically I like to think of this as using all of the tools in the toolbox that are available to us. And so we're not just pursuing chemical control, but we're also looking at integrating biological control and then eventually other strategies, including genetic approaches like breeding resistant hemlocks, as well as conserving the genetic diversity, and then forest management and silvicultural techniques. So I'd like to break these down into kind of three prongs to our approach and thinking those in terms of their time frame. So in the short term, as a stopgap measure to keep some of the hemlocks we still have alive on the landscape, we're pursuing chemical treatment. And at the same time, as a longer term strategy, we're implementing biocontrol. And then in the longest term and still under research is genetic strategies like breeding resistant trees and looking at forest management and other techniques that can be integrated with these other two. So as Logan mentioned before, one of our objectives is to increase the number of trees being treated on public lands in North Carolina. And so this includes our state public lands, but I also wanna highlight that we work with private conserved lands, especially with land trusts like Highland Cashers Land Trust. And so we do this with hired crews, with volunteers, with the Bridge Program, with the North Carolina Forest Service and Department of Corrections. And so since HRI has been around and started doing treatments in 2016, we've been able to treat over 85,000 hemlocks ourselves and with our partners in the Forest Service. And this is a huge increase over what was able to be treated in the previous decade on our state lands in North Carolina. And when I'm thinking about chemical control, you can think about how the chemical is applied to the tree. So you can apply systemic chemicals to the soil that'll be taken up by the roots and then moved into the crown of the tree. Soil drench is the easiest and most available method for landowners to do. You may also have heard of soil injection. And there's also a product now that's in a tablet form that you can also put in the soil called Cortect. The chemical can also be applied directly to the trunk. So either injecting it into the wood with stem injection or even spraying it on the bark where it's absorbed into the tree's vascular tissue and then taken up into the crown as well. And if you have smaller trees, you can use a contact insecticide like a horticultural oil or insecticidal soap. But it is important that you're able to cover the whole tree with that contact insecticide. If you're only spraying the bottom third of your hemlock and the other two thirds still have Adelgid on them, that's not really helping the tree or controlling the issue. So the upsides of chemical treatment are we know that it is effective and reliable at protecting an individual tree from hemlock woolly adelgid. Especially systemic treatments will pretty much completely remove hemlock woolly adelgid from a tree. It's easy to acquire the chemicals and to apply them even as a landowner, or it's pretty common to hire someone as well. It's much cheaper to chemically treat a hemlock than to get it removed if it's a hazard. And we know that the treatments will last for some number of years. And some updates that may be news to some of you. In the last several years, there are new imidacloprid generic products that are much less expensive than the brand name Merit that folks used to use. Research also shows that imidacloprid is effective in the tree much longer than we thought. So it can be effective against hemlock woolly adelgid for up to 7 years. There's also some new optimized dosing guidelines that allow us to reduce the overall amount of insecticide we're putting out. And that is especially true for the largest and smallest diameter sizes. And then new products like Cortect make it much easier to get back into those remote areas up on the ridgetop where you wouldn't want to lug a lot of chemical with you or to quickly and easily treat small trees that you don't have to measure out with a measuring cup. You just pop a couple tablets in for a small tree and you can do that very quickly. So the downsides of chemical treatment include that it is a short-term temporary solution, must be done repeatedly to keep protecting a tree and must be done on an individual tree level. For a landowner, this may be your ongoing strategy. For us on a larger forest scale, it's a way to keep some trees alive while we implement these other strategies and research these other strategies. There is a cost to doing it, whether you do it yourself and pay for the chemical and your time, or if you hire someone. And with any insecticide, there's always a risk of off-target exposure. And I do want to take a moment to recognize the hazard that the chemicals we use, the dinotefuran and imidacloprid products, which are neonicotinoids, and anytime you're using an insecticide, like I said, you have this risk of off-target exposure. That risk, though, is made up of first the hazard, but then also considering how much exposure there is, and that's going to make up your risk. So if you have something that's a large hazard and there's a large exposure, that's a big risk. If you have something that is an overall small hazard, but you do also have a large exposure, you can still have a pretty moderate risk. If the hazard is small and the exposure is very limited, then you have a much more minimal risk. So how does this apply to hemlocks and its risk to pollinators for treating hemlocks? Well, it really depends on how you're using and applying the chemical. So we use a targeted approach, treating the tree right at the base of the tree and avoiding surface water and avoiding the roots of flowering plants. It's helpful that hemlocks are wind pollinated and that hemlocks don't produce as much resin as some other conifers, which can be used by insects. So overall, we expect very low risk from treating hemlocks with these products if you do it in a good way. So the hazard for a neonicotinoid rite is pretty great for insects and invertebrates. If we can limit that exposure, then we can really reduce our risk. And overall, studies show that more insects are negatively impacted by the overall loss of hemlock habitat than are likely to be affected by these targeted low-dose treatments. And there's lots of research into this, and I'm really happy, I'd be happy to share any of these references. There's also a white paper linked to on our website that sums a lot of this up really nicely. So we're not talking about no risk here, but we are talking about a low-risk approach. And anytime you are making a management decision, you have to consider the trade-offs and balancing things. So our job really is to evaluate the costs and benefits of those options, and then whatever we choose to do to minimize that risk. And I do want to touch on what you can expect from chemical treatment, right? So you can't bring a dead tree back to life, but you might be surprised at how well a tree can come back just from a single treatment. So that picture on the left there, those two pictures, is a before and after of a tree that was treated once with imidacloprid and then 6 years later. And so those areas that were still alive really came back and flushed out. So once you do treat a hemlock, you would expect that hemlock woolly adelgid to disappear within a couple growing seasons. The foliage will return to health, and you should start to see a lot of good new growth. And that can take like I said, a couple growing seasons for that stress from the adelgid to be relieved. But then you should see some really great new growth coming on your trees. Looking at biological control as a strategy to integrate, this isn't a way that we're going to eradicate hemlock woolly adelgid. It's really more about establishing a predator-prey relationship. Like Logan mentioned, we don't have great natural predators for hemlock woolly adelgid in Eastern North America. And so we're bringing in predators from areas where hemlock woolly adelgid is native and trying to establish that on a landscape level as a longer-term solution. So when we're looking for a good biocontrol agent, there's a long research process that has to happen. And we want to evaluate several things. So we want to make sure that biocontrol agent is very host specific. So our host here being hemlock woolly adelgid. We want to make sure it's going to consume a lot of that host and reproduce very well. And also be able to search out on its own new areas and spread on its own, so we don't have to move it around. We want to make sure the life cycle of our biocontrol agent is synced up with the life cycle of the hemlock woolly adelgid, and ideally feeds on multiple life stages and generations of the adelgid. As we mentioned, there's those two generations a year. And then because hemlocks have, Eastern hemlock in particular, has such a wide range, we want to make sure our biocontrol agents are adapted to a wide range of conditions. So in the bottom right are some pictures. I don't know if you can see, there we go. In the bottom right are some pictures of different biocontrol agents that have been used and are being used. And I will talk about a couple of those. Oh, and I do want to mention this is a process that can take up to a decade and is regulated by APHIS, which is a federal agency. And so this is not something we do willy-nilly and just releasing things out into the woods and see what happens. So looking at a couple of these biocontrol agents, the one that we mainly work with is called Laricobius or Little Larry. And there's two species that we're using called Laricobius nigrinus and Laricobius osakensis. Laricobius nigrinus is from the Pacific Northwest, and Laricobius osakensis is actually from Southern Japan, where our lineage of hemlock woolly adelgid has been tracked back to genetically. So we go out, we've released these in various areas around Western North Carolina. And now we're still doing some releases, but mainly we're monitoring to see how they're spreading and establishing in new areas as well. So we go out and we beat on the tree, hold a sheet under that branch and look and see if these tiny little beetles, a little smaller than a sesame seed, are hanging out on those hemlocks. And this can be quite the process, but once you get good at looking for them, they're not too hard to find. And we are finding that they are establishing and spreading to areas where, you know, far from where we released them. So we know they're doing a great job of getting established on their own and seeking out new areas, but really it remains to be seen, and it's being studied, how well they're going to be able to control the adelgid and allow those trees to return to health, or as a tree comes off of chemical protection, to keep it healthy. However, one of the issues with the Laricobius is its life cycle. So Logan showed that life cycle of hemlock woolly adelgid and how it has those two generations throughout the year. Well, Laricobius does a great job on that winter generation. It's a winter active beetle, and it pupates in the soil during the summer. And so it doesn't catch that full second generation. So right about you know, late April, early May, those larvae are dropping into the soil that start to pupate, but we still have that short generation that's gonna hatch its eggs out, and those crawlers are gonna settle for that long generation and do their winter or their summer dormancy. So one of the new kids on the block is the silverfly, which is also from the Pacific Northwest. And there's been a lot of research happening in the Northeast, especially by Cornell and the New York Hemlock Initiative to evaluate this. And now it's at the stage where it's being approved on a state-by-state level for use as a management tool. So we're hoping to get the silverfly to control that late spring, early summer, as well as the winter parts of the hemlock woolly adelgid life cycle. So my emphasis here is that it's not just gonna take a single biocontrol agent, a single predator to control hemlock woolly adelgid. It's really gonna take a community of predators like is found in their native habitats. I do wanna leave some time for questions. So I'm gonna quickly touch on some of these other longer-term strategies that are being researched. So one of our partners is the Forest Restoration Alliance, and they are looking at breeding both native hemlocks that may show some resistance and amplifying that through breeding, but also hybridizing our native species, particularly Carolina hemlock seems to hybridize the best with Asian species that show some resistance. If you see hemlocks out there that seem to be doing better than their neighbors, those might show some signs of inherent resistance, and you can use this TreeSnap app to take a picture and answer some questions about that hemlock, and then that information will go to the researchers at the Forest Restoration Alliance. They can come out, check it out, see if they want to take a sample. There's also work going on to conserve the genetic diversity of hemlocks, so we don't lose that adaptability of the species, especially the eastern hemlock throughout its great range. And because Carolina hemlock is endemic and has such small populations, both are really at risk for losing that genetic diversity. And CAMCOR is the main group working on this, and they're associated with NC State. The Forest Restoration Alliance, I forgot to mention, is also associated with NC State. And then on the forest management side of things, there's some research going on studying silvicultural techniques of releasing trees from hemlock trees from competition, particularly giving them more sunlight. And so this research is looking at taking a target tree and then clearing around it, exposing it to more sunlight, and then seeing how that affects the health of the tree and the response of the hemlock woolly adelgid. So these are all great strategies we hope we'll be able to implement in the next several years. As part of our education, we have a lot of resources on our website for landowners, as well as conducting trainings and educational programs. We have a cool new video that shows you how to treat your own trees. And our website is really the main hub for a lot of that information. And this is a link that we'll share in that email that Anne's gonna send out. And then to touch on our other education programs, we do formal presentations like this, but we also give educational hikes. We'll have some of those this summer. And then we go to events and do some tabling and have some social media that Logan has done a great job working on this year. So some ways that you can help. First, just protecting your trees and monitoring them. If there's some trees you don't want to treat or aren't able to treat, you can look for those beetles on them. We have resources on our website to do that. Join us for another event like a hike or a volunteer day. We have some volunteer days coming up with the Forest Restoration Alliance, as well as doing some hemlock treatment. Generally, just spread the word about what's going on with the hemlocks and the threat they're facing and what can be done about it. You can also support state and federal programs that are working to control hemlock woolly adelgid, either one way, particularly being through advocacy. You can donate to HRI. We're a nonprofit program under WNC Communities, as Logan mentioned. And then you can check out our website and follow us on social media. So I like to wrap up with this message. You know, we title this presentation Hope for Hemlocks. And that's because in spite of all the damage we've seen in areas like this where we've seen massive mortality, there are still areas that have surviving hemlocks that really need our protection so that when this next generation of hemlocks is coming up, they have somewhere to be too. Thank you to the Village Green and to Highland Cashers Land Trust for having us. And we do have some time for questions, I think, that Anne is gonna moderate for us. But we also have a survey, I think Logan threw a link in the chat. We'd really appreciate if you could fill that out tonight, ideally right after this. You can click on the link. I think it'll open it for you, or that'll be in that follow-up email as well. Thanks a lot.
A great presentation, Tom and Logan. And I just sent a reminder in the chat, if you have questions, if you will, if you'll use the chat feature at the bottom of the Zoom screen. I haven't gotten any questions yet. I know that this presentation.
Oh, come on.
Very, very thorough, but come on, you got to challenge these guys.
Tell us about something.
But just click on the chat bubble and type in your question. I did ask and mention in my chat to everyone about the link to the survey. I see that Logan has posted that in the chat. I encourage you to go ahead and click on that link. And as soon as the presentation is over, while it's fresh in your mind, to give Logan some great feedback. And that's very helpful for him as an AmeriCorps volunteer. And just because he has the volunteer attached to it, he, you can tell, is working very, very hard. And so to get your insight and valuable feedback will mean a lot. I have received a question. Do you have a program to assist private communities? Like I'm guessing property associations and neighborhood associations to treat hemlocks?
Yeah, thanks for that question, Jack. We are more recently been able to work directly with some private communities, and we are able to do a number of things. One being as part of an educational program, we can help protect some of your trees or train the residents on how to go out and treat those trees. And we've also been working on some cost and work share programs with some different communities around. So if your HOA or POA is interested in something like that, please email me at that info@email. And we'd love to talk about some possibilities.
Oh, that's a great possibility. Sally Hodges has a question about the commercially available treatments for homeowners. I'm assuming that is on your website. Is there a direct place to look for it on your website?
Yeah, on our resources page. Logan just posted. Okay. Yeah, we have a chart on our product chart on our website that shows the products themselves. But on our resources page, we have a link to our treatment for landowners, a long page that goes step by step, like, is it a hemlock? Does it have woolly adelgid? All the way down to how to do those treatments or how to hire somebody to do those treatments. Yeah, check out that resources page and that treatment for landowners page.
I found that distinction very interesting because I mentioned to both of you that I discovered, I think, one of the hemlocks in the Village Green could have the woolly adelgid. And I am now wondering maybe if it's something different. I'm going to go take a closer look. I also had a question along the lines of the chemical treatment. Do they, the chemicals that treat the hemlocks, do they kill the beetles as well as the woolly adelgids?
Yeah, that's a great thing to consider or to keep in mind. And the short answer is Probably not that much. And a little more detail on that is basically, so these are systemic chemicals that are taken up into, you know, the tree's tissue and mostly when the woolly adelgid's feeding in the twigs. So a beetle just being on the tree isn't going to have any exposure to that. So really what it would take is an adelgid taking up some of that chemical and being eaten by a beetle before it dies, which overall, so if you have a forest full of hemlocks, you know, and there are beetles present and you're treating the trees on your property, then you're going to have a minimal impact on that overall population of beetles. And right now, I guess I didn't get into this at all, but we can't rely on these biocontrols yet, unfortunately. And I guess I did say we're monitoring or we're evaluating, or researchers are evaluating the effectiveness of Laricobius. So right now, if you solely relied on biocontrol to protect your trees, you may lose those trees, and you can't rely just on that to keep your trees healthy. So back to the question, the exposure is going to be limited, and there's also some things you can do with time of year to consider that Laricobius life cycle to even reduce that potential exposure even more.
That's a great question, and that makes a lot of sense. I have a couple of questions about, you know, forestation. Holly wants to know, does the forest canopy hinder the growth of the young hemlocks at all?
Not really. So hemlocks are very shade tolerant. They're one of the most tolerant, shade tolerant tree species around here. And so they will sprout up from seeds, and seedlings can live in the understory for a long time in almost full shade. And then when there's a gap in the canopy, those hemlocks can shoot up, you know, multiple feet a year sometimes, but they will, smaller trees can, you know, be decades old hanging out in that understory.
Well, it's interesting because Kevin has a somewhat related question. He's interested in knowing how long it takes for a planted hemlock to reach the size where it creates a beneficial microclimate.
Yeah, that really depends on how much sun that hemlock's getting. You know, what the site is like. In good soil with good water and full sun, you know, hemlocks can shoot up, like I said, feet a year, you know, and so you could get, you know, you could probably get a 20 foot tall hemlock within 20 years. And, you know, once it gets big enough to provide some shade, and if it's healthy, especially in providing really full shade, it's going to start to create that microclimate pretty soon.
That's good to know. I'm gonna come back to Gary's question in a minute, but Victoria is asking your recommendation for how to treat scale on hemlocks.
So we don't have great guidance on that. I would suggest you look for some other resources online or maybe contact Extension. The elongate hemlock scale can be controlled with systemics. Imidacloprid doesn't work on it, but dinotefuran, the other chemical we use, does. However, the dosing and the timing is important, and the dosing is higher than for hemlock woolly adelgid.
That's good input.
Overall, I will just say scale, though, by itself is really not a huge killer and is mostly just an aesthetic issue. So if you're controlling the adelgid, the scale is not going to be a huge problem.
That's what I'm hoping our tree has. And then Jack wants to know, are there resistant hemlocks that are available for sale?
So there's one, I don't know what they call it, a hybrid version that is, I don't think, yet available for sale in nurseries, but the North or the US Arboretum has created a single cross between a Carolina and a Chinese hemlock. So this isn't the bat cross version that the Forest Restoration Alliance is pursuing, but there will likely soon be a Carolina Chinese cross that you can use for landscaping. I don't know of anyone who's selling it yet, but it is being made available to nurseries.
Okay, good. I'm gonna circle back to Gary's question, but as I do, this is last call for questions. So if you have a burning question, along those lines, a treatment question just came in. Is there a specific time of year to treat?
So the best times to treat are spring and fall, when the tree is going to be moving the most water. Winter is also an acceptable time to treat. You know, the hemlocks are, as long as the ground's not frozen, the hemlocks are still working. Summer is also possible if there's enough moisture in the soil. right now. It's not even summer yet, and we've had a nice dry spell. And so I'm actually recommending folks wait to treat their trees, in these last couple of weeks, because it's just not the soil. There's not enough moisture in the soil to really guarantee that chemical is going to move up into the tree. So it has to do a little bit with the moisture in the soil, but basically spring and fall are the best times.
Yeah, and then I think after the wet spring we had, nobody wants to wish for rain, but boy, we should use some. It's getting really dry around here. And I know it's a fire concern too, which is mm-hmm. another threat to our forests. So Gary is asking about you, if you're still seeing people use the ampules that require drilling into the base of the tree.
So Gary, if you're referring to the, I think they're the Moje capsules that are available kind of commercially, that is one product that folks are still using. I mean, stem injection in general is a great method for trees that you don't want to use a soil application on. So things that are close to water, or if you have flowering plants around or flowering trees like tulip, poplar, sourwoods, magnolias, all of that stuff. Stem injection is a great method to pretty much you have to hire somebody to do that, but it is much more expensive.
I'm going to come back to a really interesting question from Jack about a very large hemlock, but first I'm going to ask Kevin's question, kind of following up to purchasing hemlocks. Are there saplings available for reforestation from the Forest Service or other organizations for large landowners?
So the North Carolina Forest Service has actually been growing hemlock seedlings, in anticipation of a resistant tree that can be produced, in great quantities. And so they're refining their protocols by growing thousands of hemlocks and are making those available for sale, typically at the 1st of July. So you can order trays of one-year-old seedlings. They come in, I think, in trays of 100. And so folks have ordered those. There might be some other commercial sources out of North Carolina, out of the state, that you can get a large number of seedlings for bigger projects.
Yeah, that's a useful question, especially for somebody that has a large property with land conservation and would love to have access to saplings. Jack wants to know, if there is a very large hemlock on the land, should they treat it or would it be best to contact you?
So assuming it's on your own property, then that's something you should definitely protect. If it's on a public land or like a conserved property that a land trust has, it would be great. You could reach out to us. It would also be great to reach out to whoever's responsible for that land. But I will say you should not go treat trees that are not on your own property, especially if they're public lands. Don't just go randomly treat those trees in the Pisgah.
Yeah, good advice. Good heart, but you don't want to do something to that might get you or somebody else in trouble. Thank you so much, Tom and Logan. This has been great information. I know we're all very concerned about the hemlock population in our area because it is a precious commodity and a valuable natural resource, as you have so eloquently stated. We'll do the best to try and send a lot of this information out in the follow-up email, including all the web links that Logan has shared in the chat, in addition, once again, to the survey, which I'll remind you, if you haven't already clicked on that, please click on it and go ahead and be prepared to respond to that survey. That's very useful information. As Gary mentioned at the top of the program, our next Village Nature series will be on June the 29th, Tuesday at 5:00. We will be in person at the Village Green, but we will also always moving forward have a virtual Zoom component, and we'll also always record it so that you'll be able to archive, go back and reference the material. So you can go on the Village Green website directly on our events calendar and click on the June 29th Village Nature Series for the link. I won't be sending, it won't be registering people for this, or you're just what for that for the Zoom link, but you're also just welcome to come to the Village Green Commons next to the Cashers Post Office at 5:00. And we're actually going to have The outreach specialist from Panthertown, Friends of Panthertown, is going to be Katie Robb, is going to be coming and speaking about the principles of Leave No Trace, and which we all feel very strongly about, in another effort to preserve our natural resources and conserve our lands. I will send a reminder with that information in the follow-up email, and as well as a link to ways that you can donate to the Village Green. And thank you again so much, Tom and Loken, and everyone for participating, and what a joy it's been to produce these Zoom programs, but I do look forward to welcoming you back in person in June. So thanks, everybody. Have a great
evening. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.